What's up, everyone? So just a heads up, this is not a sponsor or anything. It's just a place that I used to work before they laid off a bunch of people and got bought out. So I figured I'd get that disclosure out of the way. WebGuard traffic over time got really easy to actually block because the protocol never actually bothered with stuff like stealth. China's Great Wall, which is their basically the Great Firewall, fingerprints it instantly, and Russia's TSPU, deep packet inspection, kills it dead instantly as well. Iran blocks it from specific data centers, while Qatar and Saudi Arabia deployed AI-powered DPI in late 2024, I think it was, specifically, though, to catch that VPN traffic. Seven countries ran full VPN bans targeting WebGuard, which was China, Iran, Iraq, North Korea, Turkmenistan, and Russia. And I left a couple out that I forgot, but whatever. Basically, detection works because WireGuard sends every packet with a kind of giant block me sign attached to it. And WireGuard's documentation says, you know, openly that WireGuard does not focus on obfuscation. Obfuscation should happen at a layer above WireGuard. And the protocol defaults to UDP port 51820, deep packet inspection system scan for known VPN ports, and 51820 screams unencrypted tunnel here to basically any government that's actually running like basic network monitoring. DPI also examines packet structure to identify protocols, and WireGuard's kind of unique handshake message size creates fingerprints that censorship, you know, systems in general immediately recognize and just knock out. So back in January of 2019, basically there was a company that was a German surveillance company that announced they added WireGuard detection to their DPI or deep packet inspection library. The press release bragged about helping network security vendors detect the world's fastest growing VPN protocol and effectively manage VPN traffic. Stefan Klerko, sorry if I mispronounced your name, their DPI director, called WireGuard experimental, but noted its rapid acceptance, which is true. Basically, if we were to translate that kind of doublespeak, we would say, like, you know, we build tools for authoritarian regimes to identify and kill your privacy traffic before it even matured in any way. WireGuard uses UDP, and examining those UDP payloads makes identification trivial. China escalated beyond simple fingerprinting like everyone else. Their DPI systems now use machine learning to actually detect those kind of VPN patterns in real time, analyzing traffic behavior, packet timing, even stuff like the randomness of the encrypted data instead of just like matching signatures in a dumb way. Russia blocks OpenVPN, WireGuard, IKE2, version 2, and stuff like ShadowSox using TSPU infrastructure. Throughout 2023, users across Russia reported sustained failures. March in 2024 brought various laws prohibiting websites from sharing VPN information or promoting their use. And once one state proves their technology works, others tend to copy that fast. Now, I don't really cover VPN companies on this channel. I don't take any sponsors whatsoever. And that's primarily so that I can relay information with absolutely no bias whatsoever to you, the viewer. You know that when you watch one of my videos, I'm not saying this one's good or that one's good because they send me a check. And I have plenty of them who actually message me and try to get me to cover their products. And it's not something I want to do because I feel it absolutely corrupts the integrity of anyone that's actually reporting on anything. So I don't do it. One VPN provider I am going to talk about, and I didn't get paid, you know, for any of this. It's just what it is. It's you know, we're talking about VPN, so it's relevant. Mullvad specifically basically shipped version 2025.9 on September 8th this year with QUIC Obfuscation for WireGuard. And that's for all desktop platforms. Now, 3 days ago, on the 20th, they also released it for mobile devices. Android and iOS users running version 2025.8 or higher now have the kind of same censorship resistance. So Mullvad doesn't sponsor YouTube channels that I know of or pay influencers to actually shill their service, which is why I feel comfortable enough talking about it on here, because I think it's a generally known and accepted thing that this is true. So that's why I'm discussing them. I would say any YouTuber who shills a VPN and is like, you know that he's getting paid to do it, I just wouldn't trust that guy at all. That's how it works. Anyways, that to me, like them not paying, you know, YouTubers kind of already really makes them more trustworthy than any of the VPNs that we see, you know, plastered across every tech video with affiliate codes. They just basically built their product and they shipped it and they let the quality speak for itself, so to speak. Now, QUIC started as Google's project to actually make the web faster. So think of it as like HTTP version 3, if you will. It's like the old web used TCP, right? Which requires, you know, complex handshake before sending data. QUIC uses UDP instead, which is simpler. It's faster. There's no handshake delays. Like you can lose packets, but we'll get into that some other time. But connections happen in like one or two packets instead of like multiple round trips. And the protocol also fixes a problem where one lost packet would basically stall everything else that's actually waiting behind it, right? It just drops, like I said before. Now, QUIC lets multiple data streams flow completely independently. So one dropout doesn't block all the rest of what's going on behind it. Now, HTTP3, released on June of 2022, runs on QUIC instead of TCP. So what's that tell you? The entire foundation of web traffic in general really changed at that point. Google's services, they use it. YouTube uses it. Most modern websites use it. The ubiquity that exists here matters, and it matters for hiding VPN traffic. So Mask, the tunneling spec that Mullvad actually exploits, defines how to proxy UDP through HTTP. RFC 9298, which is written by a guy named David at Google, published August of 2022. Now, once you get to it, the actual spec lets HTTP clients create UDP tunnels through HTTP servers, acting as proxies. Mask hides requests and responses, semantics, multiplexes, flows over streams. It encrypts metadata and enables the unreliable delivery that UDP actually needs. Now, Mullvad wraps WireGuard's UDP packets inside of QUIC connections that look like regular HTTPS web traffic. Sensors see someone browsing websites over encrypted HTTPS, and the VPN tunnel hides inside that very envelope. Now, enabling QUIC obfuscation requires updating to version 2025.9 or higher on the desktop, or 2025.8 or higher on the mobile device, right? And you do that by going to your settings, then VPN settings, WireGuard settings, obfuscation, and selecting QUIC. Now, desktop users can also run Mullvad obfuscation set to the mode of QUIC. Now, the app automatically falls back to QUIC after a failed connection attempt in regions with active blocking. That matters beyond technical specs, right? States building things like DPI infrastructure, for example, lay the foundation for really comprehensive traffic analysis in censorship. The, you know, Great Firewall's techniques that it uses spread to other nations who are also implementing these kind of systems. Commercial surveillance vendors, like the one we mentioned earlier, absolutely profit from selling governments the capability to identify and block all kinds of privacy tools that exist. Every protocol that they actually fingerprint, every detection that they get, every signature they get, they add to their libraries, and that strengthens the digital authoritarianism, really, at the end of the day, that they actually have. And the countermeasure ecosystem really shows the ongoing arms race that we have to this day, right? Amnesia WG modifies WireGuard to complicate DPI detection, changing packet headers, randomizing handshake sizes, and other projects inject junk packets before WireGuard sessions, creating noise around the actual handshakes to try to reduce the accuracy of the detection tools. Now, tools exist specifically for converting standard WireGuard configurations into formats that actually evade DPI in China, Russia, and Iran, specifically. So Mullvad took kind of a drastic and a different approach to all this. And instead of trying to modify WireGuard or like inject nonsense or noise, they basically hide the entire protocol inside traffic that basically sensors fundamentally can't block without actually breaking the internet. Blocking all HTTPS would absolutely collapse things like commerce and governmental services, banking, just internet functionality in general. States depend on the same encrypted web infrastructure that their actual populations use. And that creates protection that is at a protocol level, so to speak. And that's something that, you know, obfuscation lacks. WireGuard plus junk packets still look like WireGuard plus garbage to things like advanced DPI systems. WireGuard inside HTTPS looks like you're reading the news or you're checking Gmail or something more innocent. Privacy tools really have to evolve faster than censorship infrastructure or we lose. That's really, at the end of the day, what this is about. Privacy advocates, like a lot of people who are actually watching this, advocate and fight kind of an asymmetric battle constantly, where one side controls physical infrastructure and legal frameworks, while the other side kind of scrambles for technical workarounds. And workarounds function until they stop functioning. And then the actual cycle repeats with new detection methods and new obfuscation techniques and new iterations and whatnot. QUIC Obfuscation exploits current censorship technology that exists by hiding inside those traffic patterns that sensors really just can't afford to block. Overall, I'd say that QUIC and Mullvad's implementation of it is relatively flawless and pretty awesome. And we do see some of these same implementations inside of networks like Tor, but that's for another video. We'll get into that some other time, maybe. I think I've actually already done a video on that. In any case, I wanted to give this like a quick, you know, once over. I know it's not a super low level breakdown, but at the end of the day, I thought it was a topic that we should definitely talk about because it's got a lot of relevance in today's day and age. And another topic that I'm gonna get into eventually is I've been slow on the videos because I've been doing a ton of infrastructure work behind the scenes, trying to build up multiple things. And I'll get into that more on my blog. And I'm going to publish a video for those of you who, you know, support the mission by being on there and whatnot. But in any case, I hope you all are doing well. And I hope you can actually see this video. It's not requiring ID in the state you're in. And your state hasn't made VPNs illegal yet. And we have a lot to cover. I've been trying to do a lot of stuff. I have a lot of stuff I have to do. We have a lot to talk about. I look forward to seeing you guys in the next video.